This is called the Honeyball Suta. This particular sutta is really an amazing sutta. And there is a book that is quite good called Concept and Reality. And it's taken from the Honeyball Suta. When I first ran across it, I'd been a monk for, 2 or 3 years. And a monk gave me that, and he said, it's the best book that I've read so far. And he gave me a copy of it, and I read it, and it was really one of the best Dhamma books I've ever read. So when I was in Sri Lanka a couple years ago, I found the author. He is an old monk. He's about 83 or 84 years old, very frail. And I went to visit him with the idea that what I wanted to do was print up a few thousand copies of it, so that I could give it out to other people, because it is such a good book. So I went to ask permission to do that, and he said no. And I said, well, that's really unfortunate, because I wanted to give this out to a lot of different people. And then he started talking about, it's not in print right now, and there's this place in America called Dhamma Sukha Meditation Center that wrote to me, and they want 250 copies. And I said, that's me. But he didn't give me permission. This year, when I went, I talked to one of the printers that printed up his book. And the printer got in touch with him, and I told him that I would buy 500 copies at least so that I could have them and give them out. Unfortunately, in Sri Lanka, to get anything of any size out of the country, it takes at least 6 months before it comes. They have a container that anything going to other countries, it goes in that container, and they don't send it out until it's full. So it takes 6 months to get the stuff in. Hopefully by next year at this time, I will have some copies so I can give them out. This particular book, He wrote this as his PhD thesis. And he was almost done with it, and he got sick. And then he didn't get his thesis in on time. And as it turns out, there was a couple other monks that did their thesis on the same one. And they decided, well, we don't need another one. So he had to pick a whole new theme and rewrite his doctorate dissertation. About 15 years later, he was visiting Jnanapanika, who started up the Buddhist Publication Society in Sri Lanka. And he showed the book to Jnanapanika, and Jnanapanika said, this is a great book. Why don't you print it up and we'll give it out with, when people order books at BPS, they always give complimentary books along with it. So that's how this book came into being. And it is quite brilliant. Now, he wrote another book called The Magic of Mind, I think it was. And it's very popular in Sri Lanka. It's not a thick book. It's only 50 pages or something like that. So I asked him about this other book. Where did he get that? Where did he get the information for this other book? And he said, well, it's from the Anguttara Nikaya. So I looked it up in the Anguttara Nikaya, and it was two sentences. And he wrote a 50-page book on it. That's really remarkable. He's quite a scholar, and he has other books that are becoming available. So that's just some of the history of how this particular sutta became popular with the Westerners.
Could you repeat the name of that book, please?
Concept and Reality by Jnanadanda. You can get that book online. I don't remember how.
It's on our webpage.
So that's an easy way to find it. It's all there. But we're going to be having 500 copies, so I can give the copies out, so you don't have to read it on the screen.
But it's not on our Twitter feed.
Thank God for little things.
Say that now.
That's right.
So, thus have I heard on one occasion the Blessed One was living in the Sakyan country at Kapvilavatu in Negrota's park. Then, when it was morning, the Blessed One dressed and taking his bowl and outer robe, went into Kapvilavatu for alms. When he had wandered for alms in Kapvilavatu and had returned from his alms round after his meal, he went to the great wood for the day's abiding. Entering the great wood, sat down at the root of a bilva sapling for the day's abiding. Dandapani, the Sakyan, while walking and wandering for exercise, also went to the great wood. And when he had entered the great wood, he went to the bilva sapling where the Blessed One was and exchanged greetings with him. When this courteous and amiable talk was finished, he stood at one side, leaning on a stick, and asked the Blessed One, What does the recluse assert? What does he proclaim? Now, Dandapani was a Sakyan, and he was also a Brahmin. And he was a semi-popular teacher of the Vedas in Kapvilavatu. So the Blessed One said, "Friend, I assert and proclaim my teaching in such a way that one does not quarrel with anyone in the world, with its gods, its maras, and its brahmas, in this generation with its recluses and brahmins, its princes and its people, in such a way that perceptions no more underlie the brahmin who abides detached from sensual pleasures, without perplexity, shorn of worry, free from craving of any kind." When this was said, Dandapani the Sakyan shook his head, wagged his tongue, and raised his eyebrows until his forehead was puckered with three lines. Then he departed, leaning on his stick. Then, when it was evening, the Blessed One rose from meditation and went to Negrota's park. where he sat down on a seat made ready for him and told the monks what had taken place. Then a certain monk asked the Blessed One, "But venerable sir, how does the Blessed One assert and proclaim his teachings in such a way that one does not quarrel with anyone in the world, with its gods, its maras, and its brahmas, in this generation with its recluses and brahmins, its princes and its people? And venerable sir, how is that perception no more, how is it that perception no more underlie the Blessed One, that the Brahmin who abides detached from sensual pleasures, without perplexity, shorn of worry, free from craving of any kind of being? Monk, as to the source through which perceptions and notions born of mental proliferation beset a man." What is mental proliferation? All of the nonsense thoughts that we get caught up in. All of the things that pull us away from what we're doing, and we become so involved in things we don't even know we have a body anymore. You know that kind of state? Okay, that's mental proliferation. "If nothing is found there to delight in, welcome, and hold to, this is the end of the underlying tendency of lust, of the underlying tendency of aversion, of the underlying tendency to views." That's one of the big problems with most people in the world. That's why wars are fought. "Of the underlying tendency to doubt, of the underlying tendency to conceit, of the underlying tendency to desire for becoming, of the underlying tendency to ignorance, this is the end of resorting to rods and weapons, of quarrels, brawls, disputes, recrimination, malicious words, and false speech. Here, these evil, unwholesome states cease without remainder." So what is he talking about? Letting go of craving. "That is what the Blessed One said. Having said this, the Sublime One rose from his seat and went into his dwelling. Then, soon after, the monks considered, 'Now, friends, the Blessed One has risen from his seat and gone into his dwelling after giving a summary in brief without expounding the detailed meaning. Now, who will expound this in detail?' Then they considered, 'The venerable Mahakachana is praised by the teacher and esteemed by his wise companions in the holy life. He is capable of expounding the detailed meaning. Suppose we went to him and ask him this meaning.'" Now, one of the things that happened with the Buddha is somebody would ask him a question, and he would give them a short answer. And if they didn't say, "Okay, I think I need to have that explained a little bit more," if they weren't, if they didn't do that, then the Buddha would get up and think, "Okay, everybody understood." He'd go into his kuti so he could have some private time to do whatever he was going to do. So these guys, they decided they wanted to know what the detailed meaning was because they didn't understand it. So they wanted to go to somebody else who could expound it. And Mahakachana was often praised for his understanding of the Dhamma and the way he could expound it. suppose we went to him and asked him the meaning of this. Then the monks went to the venerable Mahakachana and exchanged greetings with him. When this courteous and amiable talk was finished, they sat down at one side and told him what had taken place, adding, "Let the venerable Mahakachana expound it to us." Now Mahakachana is going to cuff them up a little bit for not thinking to ask when the Buddha was there. The venerable Mahakachana replied, "Friends, it is though a man needing heartwood, seeking heartwood, wandering in search of heartwood, thought the heartwood should be sought for among the branches and leaves of the great tree standing possessed of heartwood. After he had passed over the root and the trunk, and so it is with you, venerable sirs, that you think I should be asked about the meaning of this after you passed the Blessed One by. When you were face to face with the teacher, for knowing, the Blessed One knows. Seeing, he sees. He is vision. He is knowledge. He is the Dhamma. He is the Holy One, the sayer, the proclaimer, the elucidator of meaning, the giver of the deathless, the Lord of the Dhamma, the Tathagata. That was the time when you should have asked the Blessed One the meanings. As he told you, you should have remembered it. Surely, friend Kachana, knowing the Blessed One knows, seeing he sees. He is vision, he is knowledge, he is the Dhamma. He is the Holy One. He is the sayer, the proclaimer, the elucidator of meaning, the giver of the deathless, the Lord of the Dhamma, the Tathagata. That was the time that we should have asked the Blessed One the meaning. As he told us, we should have remembered it yet. The venerable Mahakachana is praised by the teacher and esteemed by his wise companions in the holy life. The venerable Mahakachana is capable of expounding the detailed meaning of this summary given in brief by the Blessed One without expounding the detailed meaning. Let the venerable Mahakachana expound it without finding it troublesome. Then listen, friends, and attend closely to what I shall say." This is a very important statement, because if you listen to this sutta and you do understand what it is saying, you can become a sotapanna by listening. Don't let your mind wander. Don't let your mind start thinking about, "Wish I had another cup of tea. I got to go to the bathroom now. I'm bored with this. I don't understand what this is talking about." All of those kind of thoughts, let them go and let this sink in. It's important. "Listen, friends, and attend closely to what I shall say." "Yes, friend," the monks replied. "The venerable Mahakachana said this: Friends, when the Blessed One rose from his seat and went into his dwelling after giving a summary in brief without expounding the detailed meaning, that is, monks, as to the source through which perceptions and notions born of mental proliferation beset a man, if nothing is found there to delight in, welcome, and hold to, this is the end of the underlying tendency to lust. This is the end of resorting to rods and weapons. Here, these evil, unwholesome states without remainder. I understand the detailed meaning to be as follows. Mental proliferation, thinking about this, thinking about that, having opinions about this, having ideas about this or that, is all mental proliferation. And when it starts, you want your six R's. You want to practice your six R's so you can let go of these things that you're identifying with. This is my idea. It's my opinion. I think it's this way. I don't care what you think. That's all mental proliferation, and it's all caused by craving and clinging. Dependent on the eye and forms, eye consciousness arises. The meeting of the three is eye contact. With eye contact as condition, there is eye feeling. What one feels, that one perceives. What one perceives, that one thinks about. An interesting thing with perception, because it is such a different definition, is most people, they have a lot of thoughts, but they don't realize that every thought that you have is a concept. What is a concept? This is a chair. Where's the chair? Is it the arms? Is it the back? Is it the legs? Where is the chair? The chair is a concept made up of a lot of little tiny parts that put together make up the idea of a chair. Perceptions are concepts. When you let go and relax that tightness in your mind, you have let go of and perceptions. Now your mind is clear, your mind is bright, there are no thoughts in it. And you bring that back to your smile and your object of meditation, which is wholesome. Now, one of the reasons I like to teach loving kindness meditation is because it doesn't have to do with mental proliferation. This has to do with feeling. And it's something that's quite tangible. You can feel that radiating loving kindness. You can feel that happiness coming up. So this is really important to understand. All of the mental proliferation that we get involved with is just dealing with ideas and concepts. They don't necessarily have anything to do with reality. When you use that six R's, even with your daily activity, and you relax that tightness, and you put a little smile in your mind, the smile is very important because it helps keep your mind light. Doesn't grab on to things. And then you start sending loving and kind thoughts to yourself or other beings. Now, I'm going to give you an example of this by another sutta. This is called the simile of the saw. Oops, I hit the simile of the snake, and I need the simile of the saw. there are these five courses of speech that others may use when they address you. Their speech may be timely or untimely, true or untrue, gentle or harsh, connected with good or connected with harm, spoken with a mind of loving kindness or with inner hatred. When others address you, their speech may be timely or untimely. When others address you, their speech may be true or untrue. When others address you, their speech may be gentle or harsh. When others address you, their speech may be connected with good or connected with harm. When others address you, their speech may be spoken with a mind of loving kindness or with inner hate. Herein you should train thus. Our minds will remain unaffected, and we shall utter no evil words. We shall abide compassionate for their welfare with a mind of loving kindness without inner hate. We shall abide pervading that person with a mind imbued with loving kindness, and starting with him, we shall abide pervading the all-encompassing world with a mind imbued with loving kindness, abundant, exalted, immeasurable, without hostility and without ill will. That is how you should train. So what is that saying? It's saying let go of the mental proliferation, because somebody comes at you and they tell you something that you know is a lie. What happens in your mind when you know that happens? And it doesn't really matter. When you're talking with other people, it doesn't matter what they're saying. What matters is what is happening in you. And when you start radiating loving kindness to that person, and then use that person as the reminder to radiate loving kindness to all beings in all the directions, what do you think? Is your world going to be filled with peace and calm or not? How many people get upset because they said this to me, and or they said it this way, and I don't like them to talk that way to me? And what kind of mental proliferation do you get caught in? Sometimes for months, holding a grudge. They said that to me, I'm never going to forgive them. Now this is an amazing sutta, because everybody thinks meditation is about sitting on the cushion. That's it. When I get up from meditation, I'm going to go do whatever I do and say whatever I want to say. I don't have to pay attention to what I learned on the cushion. There's no mental development that way. When you start seeing the practicalness of practicing loving kindness meditation, and you start radiating that loving kindness to someone that is giving you a hard time, and they can be cursing at you, and they can be doing all kinds of problems for you, but when you start radiating loving kindness, there's all kinds of interesting things that happen. People that are fighting with each other, they start yelling, oh, the terrible things that they say, and how they harm other people just because of something that was said. When you start radiating loving kindness to someone that is truly angry, what do you think happens? when there is anger coming at you, you have a choice. You can take that anger, make it your anger, and then throw that anger back at them. Now you're at war. And you say things that you wish you hadn't said later. And you do things that you wish you hadn't done. But that's one choice you have. The other is, when somebody comes at you with their anger, you know what it feels like to be angry. Do you think that person is happy at that moment? Not hardly. You know how they're suffering. Their face gets real dark color, red or black. They're yelling. Their body is tense. That's suffering. So you have compassion for that person. What's one definition of compassion? Seeing another person in pain, allowing them the space to have their pain, but loving them no matter what. That's what this is teaching. When you start radiating loving kindness to somebody that's angry at you, before long, they stop yelling so much. They stop talking so loudly. They stop cursing so much. And you continue doing it, and they calm down. I've seen this happen many times. Then you can start discussing what the real problem is. I say discuss, not fight with. So what this is teaching us is how to live a life without a lot of mental proliferation. Because somebody that comes at you and you get mad and throw it back, what do you think about when they go away? What they said, what I said, what I should have said to them. I'm right. They're wrong. And just like on a tape deck, that whole scene plays over again. And after a little while later, plays over again. Now, you have that dissatisfaction. You're causing yourself suffering. You're causing yourself pain. And the next person you see, how do you treat them? With loving kindness and understanding? Or do you start complaining about that no good so-and-so because they made me mad? That's a wrong kind of statement. They can't make you mad. You make yourself mad. Why? Because of your mental proliferation and you're holding on to certain ideas of the way things are supposed to be. And when they aren't like that, how much do you dislike it? How much do you fight it? Every time you have repeat thoughts, guess who is causing themselves suffering? Now, you can blame somebody else for it. But it's not theirs. Yes?
If they don't make you make me mad, can they still make you happy? Or are you making yourself happy?
You make yourself happy. You're responsible. This is one of the reasons I like to follow the Buddha's path. Because it's total self-responsibility. Somebody can say something nice and you say, that's nice. But that doesn't make you truly happy. You have to be happy in yourself. This is why when I tell you I want you to send loving kindness to yourself for a little while, you start appreciating yourself more. I had some students in Malaysia at one time that they were really negative people. I mean, they never said anything nice. They only criticized other people. And it got tiresome being around them. So I told them something that I wanted them to do. I wanted them to sit down with a piece of paper and write down 10 good qualities that they like in themselves. And after they got that done, then I said, I want you to start reflecting how you are like that and how you can see that quality in other people. And that led directly to their own happiness. And the next day I said, okay, get another piece of paper. I want you to write down 10 more good qualities about yourself. Can't repeat them. Made them think. Made them realize that the anger and hatred that they were continually giving out to other people was hurting themselves. And it made everybody else around them unhappy to hear that sort of thing, because most people, they don't take responsibility for their own pain. Most people, they want to make excuses. Well, he didn't do it the way he was supposed to, and that made me unhappy. Well, let's back off on that a little bit. When you truly start appreciating yourself and loving yourself for your good qualities and the kind of actions that you choose to have that are helpful for you and everyone else around you, there is personality development that leads to your benefit and well-being for a long time. Now, I've had some students that say, well, you're being completely selfish and egocentric if you just send love to yourself. And one of the things that the Buddha said was, anyone who truly loves themselves will never say or do anything to harm anyone else. So the more you start looking at your own good qualities and how you like them, the more the bad qualities start disappearing. You want to be successful in life? Start looking at the positive things that you are and that you do and how you appreciate that in yourself. And when you see that in yourself, you start looking around at other people and you start saying, oh, you've got that quality too. And you start appreciating them more. Now, getting back to this particular sutta, monks, if you keep this advice on the simile of the saw constantly in mind, do you see any course of speech, trivial or gross, that you could not endure? You want to affect the world around you in a positive way? You start radiating loving kindness to everybody that you talk to. Let go of the mental proliferation. Let go of your opinions and ideas. Ah, this government is such a... Let go of that. You're only causing hatred and dissatisfaction to arise in your own mind. And then you start affecting the world around you through your fear, through your anxiety, through your dislike. And that's why the world is in its state right now. Because there are so many greedy people that want things to be the way they want it to be. They don't care what anybody else wants. They're very selfish. Therefore, you should keep this advice on the simile of the saw constantly in your mind. This will lead to your welfare and happiness for a long time. And it does. Okay. Okay, dependent on the I and forms, I consciousness arises. The meeting of the three is I contact. So if you take a good working I, color and form, and I consciousness, and the meeting of these three things together is called contact. Contact arises right before feeling arises. With contact, or with eye contact as condition, there is eye feeling. What one feels, that one perceives. What one perceives, that one thinks about. What one thinks about, that one mentally proliferates. With what one mentally proliferated as the source, perceptions and notions born of mental proliferation beset a man with respect to the past, future, and present forms cognizable through the eye.
With the feeling, the perception, and the thoughts, are those linear, or is it that are they conjoined?
You have the wrong idea of conjoined. Well, but it is, all of them are linear. What one feels, that one perceives. If feeling doesn't arrive, are you going to perceive anything?
No.
Are you going to have that consciousness arise?
Well,
no. Wait till you come to Dhammasukha. we'll have discussions on this, and I'll show you more clearly. Okay. Dependent on the ear and sounds, dependent on the nose and odors, dependent on the tongue and flavors, dependent on body and tangibles, dependent on mind and mind objects, mind consciousness arises. The meeting of these three is contact. With contact as condition, there is feeling. What one feels, that one perceives. What one perceives, that one thinks about. You hear it? Does that sound like it's linear or all mixed up together?
Sounds very linear.
Okay. What one thinks about, that one mentally proliferates. With what one has mentally proliferated as the source, perceptions and notions born of mental proliferation beset a man with respect to the past, future, and present mind objects as cognizable through the mind.
So
When there is the I of form and I consciousness, it is possible to point out the manifestation of contact. When there is the manifestation of contact, it is possible to point out the manifestation of feeling. This is how dependent origination works. When there is the manifestation of feeling, it is possible to point out the manifestation of perception. When there is the manifestation of perception, it is possible to point out the manifestation of craving. When there is the manifestation of craving, it is possible to point out the manifestation of thinking. When there's the manifestation of thinking, it is possible to point out the manifestation of besetment by perceptions and notions born of proliferation.
Is besetment mean habitual patterns?
Yeah.
The word for thinking here, would that be sankhara or upadana?
Upadana. When there is the ear sounds, ear consciousness. When there is the nose, odor, nose consciousness. When there is the tongue, flavor, tongue consciousness. When there is the body, a tangible and body consciousness. When there is mind, a mind object and mind consciousness. It is possible to point out the manifestation of contact. When there is the manifestation of contact, it is possible to point out the manifestation of feeling. What is feeling? Are we talking about emotions here?
No.
Okay. When there is the manifestation of feeling, it is possible to point out the manifestation of perception. When there is the manifestation of perception, it is possible to point out the manifestation of craving. When there is the manifestation of craving, it is possible to point out the manifestation of thinking. When there is the manifestation of thinking, it is possible to point out the manifestation of besetment by perceptions and notions born of mental proliferation. You getting this? You understanding it? Okay. Do you see how much pain we cause ourselves through our lack of mindfulness? Through our lack of practicing the six R's when something first starts to come up? How much pain do we cause ourselves? I mean, this is not just for one short moment. This is life. We get caught by our opinions and our ideas, and we suffer because of it. This is the brilliance of recognizing what craving is and letting it go. As soon as you recognize that tension and tightness in your head, in your mind. Now, I say head and mind. I'm talking about brain and mind when I say head. But this is also describing nama rupa, mentality and materiality. These are always hooked together. It kind of reminds me of that real famous movie that was made in the late 90s, I think it was, called The Matrix. if you die in one place, if you're in a mental realm and your body dies, will you die? Body cannot, mind cannot live without body. Everything is interconnected. So, mind and body are very intricately connected. And this is one of the things that makes a big difference between what the Buddha was practicing when he was a bodhisattva and what he was teaching after he became the Buddha. Because they had a belief that because of the one-pointed concentration, you get to a certain degree of concentration, you don't feel your body at all. Forget your bodies, nothing. Everything is mental. Well, you can't have one without the other. Now, I've tested people that are practicing one-pointed concentration. You come up and poke them with a stick. No reaction. They don't know that it's happening. Where'd it go? You ought to put it on this side. You take a loud bell and ring it right by their ear. They don't hear it. They don't know they have a body now. Their mind is so absorbed on one mental object that there is no full awareness. Now, this is why, another reason why so many people get confused when they start hearing about jhana. Because the standard definitions of jhana have to do with absorption concentration. And there's some very famous teachers that will tell you that when you get to the fourth jhana, you don't breathe anymore. You don't hear anything anymore. You just stay glued onto that one little point of concentration. That's it. And it's really great. Well, there's a few things that happen when you're doing that. One, the force of the concentration makes all this other stuff disappear. So you think that you're just in a mental realm. But there is a lot of talk about being fully aware. And when you're in jhana that the Buddha teaches, it is a different kind of jhana than what everybody else is practicing. And it became so popular that a lot of monks now are saying that all jhana is the same and it's what we say it is. They don't realize that there's two different kinds of jhana. There's an absorption jhana and there is an aware jhana. So when somebody is sitting in the fourth jhana, they are breathing through their ears, they're breathing through their skin. They don't breathe through their lungs, supposedly. But I can go up to them and they're sitting and I can grab onto their hand and I can put it on top of their head. They don't know it's like that. And it'll stay like that till they come out of that jhana. And then they go, what happened? They don't know because the force of the concentration and the lack of awareness of what's happening around them causes a different kind of end result. The end result of doing one-pointed concentration is you get very blissful. You get into some real high, heavy-duty, happy feelings. But the kind of jhana that the Buddha taught, you have full awareness, and you are letting go of craving many, 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 many times. And because that, you have full awareness without any attachment in it. There is no more I am that. Now, a lot of people are very much afraid of no self. That's the literal translation of anatta. A-N-N means basically no. Atta means self. And you notice that I don't use that term. Isn't that strange? I use the term impersonal. So many people are afraid if I really have anatta, I'm not going to be there anymore. It's going to be nothing. And I've run across some of the different teachers in Theravada as well as Mahayana that they like to talk about voidness and that sort of thing like it's nothing. There's nothing there. And the impersonal nature is such that you're still here, you're still alive, you just don't have that false belief in a personal self. You're letting go of that every time you let go of craving. Doesn't mean you disappear. It means you have a clearer mind as to how things work and how things truly are without looking through colored lenses of my ideas, my opinions, my stuff. You stub your toe. What do you do when you stub your toe? First thing you do?
Swear.
Yeah. And swear. And then jump around and be mad because that pain is there. And what are you sending into that pain? Dissatisfaction, dislike, a lot of hatred. You know what happens when you do that? That pain becomes really, really, really intense. And that pain will stay around for a long time. Anytime you have pain in your body, doesn't matter whether you get a cut or you scrape or you smash something with doing something, what your body is telling you right then, right there, when that pain arises is, hey, love me. I hurt. Send me love. Now this is fairly scientific what I'm showing you. You have the pineal gland. The pineal gland is in the middle of your brain, in between the two lobes. And it produces endorphins. And endorphins are the natural body painkiller. It's about 10 times stronger than morphine. It's pretty strong. But when you have anger and dislike, the blood vessels start to close down because you have a tight brain at the time around the very thing that you want to open up. And when that closes down, the pain becomes much more intense. Now, when you start sending love and kindness into that, you're relaxing this tightness. Oh, the endorphins can come out. The painkiller goes into the toe, and before long you kind of forget that you even did it. Now, I've said this quite a few times on different talks, but when I was a monk, I used to walk around in the forest barefooted at night. And that's not the smartest thing to do. And I have a lot of broken toes because of it. So, I really began to understand the importance of relaxing into these things instead of fighting with it and getting into my mental proliferation about it and my ideas and my concepts and my opinions and how I don't like that feeling and I want it to go away. But when you start putting loving and kind thoughts into that, the pain dissipates fairly quickly. And heals very quickly. So when I would stub my toe in the forest, and in Asia they have a real annoying habit of making this room is good. Now you go to the hallway there to go to the bathroom, they put a lip that's about that big. So you can't see it, and it's real good for kicking. That's another way that I broke my toes quite a few times. What happens is the first thing in my mind that I noticed was there's pain. And then I noticed that I didn't like the pain and tightened. And as soon as I saw that, without mental proliferation, I started relaxing and started sending loving kindness into the thing that is painful. And within 4 or 5 minutes, I was still limping a little bit, but it didn't hurt anymore. And it might take a few days of some slight limping before it would heal. Now, the first time I broke my toe, I went to the doctor and I asked him what they could do for it. And the doctor had a great sense of humor. He said, if we get a bow and put on it, that'll remind you not to do that anymore. There's nothing you can do for the toes. It doesn't work. So you have to grin and bear it. But every time I was walking, whenever the pain was there, I would start sending loving kindness into that again. And after 2 or 3 days, I didn't have a limp and I'd forgotten that I did it. But when people get into their hatred and get into their dissatisfaction and their mental proliferation, and they will have pain in their foot for 2 or 3 weeks. That shows you the healing power of letting go of craving and relaxing and sending loving kindness into the thing that's bothering you. It does work. Okay. Okay, when there is no I, no form, no I consciousness, it is impossible to point out the manifestation of contact. Do you hear that?
Yeah.
Okay. When there is no manifestation of contact, it is impossible to point out the manifestation of feeling. When there's no manifestation of feeling, it is impossible to point out the manifestation of perception. When there's no manifestation of perception, it is impossible to point out the manifestation of craving. When there's no manifestation of craving, it is impossible to point out manifestation of thinking. When there's no manifestation of thinking, it is impossible to point out the manifestation of besetment by perceptions and notions born of mental proliferation. So, what is that saying? If your mindfulness is sharp enough that you start to see contact arise and you relax right then, feeling won't arise. If feeling doesn't arise, craving won't arise. If craving doesn't arise, your mental proliferation doesn't arise. If that doesn't arise, your habitual tendencies don't arise. If the habitual tendencies don't arise, the birth of action doesn't arise. If the birth of action doesn't arise, sorrow, pain, lamentation, grief, and despair won't arise. Now, that's letting go of suffering, isn't it? And it just takes being observant of how this process works. And you're not going to catch it all the time. It's a matter of practice. And it's a matter of many thousands, many hundreds of thousands of 6 hours. You know, a lot of people, they talk about the Four Noble Truths and the cessation of suffering. And they're talking about Nibbana. But what is Nibbana? Ni is a negative, no. Bana, fire. So Nibbana means no fire. In one of the suttas called the Fire Sutta, the Buddha talked quite a bit about everything is burning. The eye is burning, the color and forms are burning, the eye consciousness is burning, eye contact is burning, eye feeling is burning. Burning with what? The fire of craving. Every time you use the 6 R's, you are letting go of the fire. You're letting go of craving. So you are experiencing Nibbana, no more fire. This is mundane. And that means worldly. That means that there are many, many times that you have to use that before your mind finally makes up its mind that, yeah, let's go to the next level and go to the super mundane, where the craving can be let go of all the way. When there's no ear, no sound, no ear consciousness, when there's no nose, no odor, no nose consciousness, when there's no tongue, no flavor, no tongue consciousness, when there's no body, no tangible, no body consciousness, when there's no mind, no mind object, no mind consciousness, it is impossible to point out the manifestation of besetment of perceptions and notions born of mental proliferation. Are you starting to understand the involvement with your thinking doesn't really mean much? Everything in this world, every thought, every feeling, every sensation is not you. It is impersonal. But we keep on taking everything so personally, and we cause ourselves so much pain by having something come up, not liking it, grabbing onto it, mentally proliferating it, which makes it bigger and more intense. That we keep on going from lifetime after lifetime after lifetime suffering because we don't see how this process actually does work. And the thing that makes this such a remarkable discovery by the Buddha is that it's so simple to let it go. 6R. Use right effort. Right effort, according to the Four Noble Truths, according to the Eightfold Path, Recognize when an unwholesome states arise. What's an unwholesome state? Anything that has craving in it. That's unwholesome. Release the unwholesome state and relax. Bring up a wholesome state. Smile. Come back to your object of meditation. Stay with your object of meditation for as long as you can. Right effort. 6 R's. Same, same. The 6 R's will take you all the way to complete cessation of all suffering, arahatship. Not bad. One simple thing in that whole description that I gave you is the key to getting off of the wheel of samsara so you don't have to suffer anymore. Let go of the craving. Relax. See your mind become clear and bright and pure because you've let go of that false belief in a personal self. Oh boy, I don't know if I'm going to get through this tonight.
I haven't got through one yet.
I did. Last night, I did. I got through it. I didn't read it all, but I got through it. Friends, when the Blessed One rose from his seat and went into his dwelling after giving a summary in brief without expounding the detailed meaning, that is, monks, as to the source through which perceptions and notions born of mental proliferation beset a man, if nothing is found there to delight in, welcome, and hold to, this is the end of the underlying tendency to lust, the underlying tendency to aversion, the underlying tendency of views, the underlying tendency of doubt, the underlying tendency of craving, the underlying tendency of conceit, the underlying tendency to desire for being reborn, of the underlying tendency to ignorance. This is the end of resorting to rods and weapons, quarrels and brawls, disputes, recrimination, malicious words, and false speech. Here, these evil, unwholesome states cease without remainder. I understand the detailed meaning of the summary of this. Now, friends, if you wish, go to the Blessed One and ask him about the meaning of this. As the Blessed One explains it to you, you should remember it. Then the monks, having delighted and rejoiced in the Venerable Mahakachana's words, rose from their seats and went to the Blessed One. After paying homage to him, sat down at one side and told the Blessed One all that had taken place after he had left, adding, "Then, Venerable Sir, we went to the Venerable Mahakachana and asked him about the meaning. The Venerable Mahakachana expounded the meaning to us with these terms, statements, and phrases." Mahakachana is wise, monks. Mahakachana has great wisdom. If you had asked me the meaning of this, I would have explained it to you in the same way that Mahakachana has explained it. Such is the meaning of this, and you should remember it. When this was said, the Venerable Ananda said to the Blessed One, "Venerable Sir, just as if a man exhausted by hunger and weakness came across a honey ball, wherever he would taste it, he would find sweet, delectable flavor. So too, Venerable Sir, any able-bodied monk, wherever he might scrutinize with wisdom the meaning of this discourse on the Dhamma, would find satisfaction and confidence of mind. Venerable Sir, what is the name of this discourse on the Dhamma? As to that, Ananda, you may remember this discourse as the Dhamma, on the Dhamma, as the Honeyball discourse." That is what the Blessed One said, and Venerable Ananda was satisfied and delighted in his words. So, how much pain and suffering do we want to continue giving ourselves through our rigid holding on to ideas, opinions, and concepts?
None.
I want to I want to encourage you to start looking at how these things arise. Don't spend all your time trying to figure it out. Just look and observe, and you'll start seeing. A painful feeling arises, I don't like it. Now you have thoughts about it, opinions, ideas, mental proliferation. And right after that, your habitual behavior. When this kind of thing arises, I always act that way, and I always cause myself a lot more suffering because of the mental proliferation. So when you see a feeling begin to arise, not too fast, not too slow, relax into that. When you do that, all the mental proliferation gives way, and you start seeing the world in a different way, because it's not clouded by your opinions and concepts and ideas. It's not clouded by your emotional reaction to what happens. That's the way that leads to true happiness. My sincerest wish for you is that you improve your mindfulness so much that you can catch the craving and let it go. Okay. Yeah.
I'm a little slow picking this up, but I'm looking at the calls and dominoes. Contact, feeling, or perception, thinking, resentment, mental proliferation. How does that map onto the sort of traditional 12 links? There's the contact and feeling tone.
Well, feeling and perception, they're conjoined. Craving?
It
doesn't say it, but I was saying it.
Right. So that's
desire?
No, craving. I like it, I don't like it. Craving. When the feeling arises, craving arises right after that. And that's how you recognize. Don't worry, I'm working on that particular sutta right now. It's going to be fixed.
Yeah, that's 3 years waiting for
me. You really know how to hurt a guy, don't you? Why don't you come to Dhamma Sukha and help me?
I'll be there this summer.
All summer? I mean, what there are three short pamphlets that I'm working on, and two books, and then you want me to be doing that, which is extremely difficult.
I was just asking about those things.
Yeah. So you got to give me a little bit of time to do it. Because the translation work, what I started doing with Kusala is tell me the Pali, give me good definitions, and I'll give you the definitions I think should be there. And it's working quite nice. But it takes a long time. My goal was to change some of the translation of every sutta to match more closely with the Pali. And it's tricky because Pali has words that don't translate. So we have to come up with something that really does work through your own practice, that means close enough.
I mean, the other thing that's a little confusing about this is that, you know, in the standard 12, there is no perception.
No, because the perception and feeling are lumped together.
But you can perceive contact, you perceive feeling, you can perceive the others. So perception
perceiving the notions is what's happening.
Yeah, but you can also perceive feeling tone, and you can perceive.
You're getting things. You're taking from one sutta and trying to make it exactly work for another, and sometimes it doesn't.
Yes, that was my question: was where does it reconcile, and where is it just?
Well, I just told you where it reconciles. Mm-hmm. So you have ignorance, formations. And it doesn't mention all of that in there.
Right.
So, you know, sometimes the Buddha would just use parts to make a point in a particular way. But he might change that a little bit the next time he does it in another way. But it's consistent enough. Right.
So I was just trying to get the stuff so I could see how it fit together.
Well, you just work with the 12 links until you really know them. then we'll start doing other things.
Other links to work with.
Well, they're different names for the same things, though.
That's
right. You're right.
Yeah, I mean, and that's highly instructional to the.
You'll get to hear it in a little while.
So I could take this up with you elsewhere, but actually, what I'm asking about is exactly what you're saying, was actually watching these come up, you know, in experience, and then there are slightly different sort of labels.
So you have to perceive the feeling in order to relax.
And you have to perceive the feeling in order to know that it's painful or pleasant. But he doesn't put that in the links. It is understood. Yeah. Don't get caught up in that kind of stuff.
But the thing is that in reality, I'm trying to see how to handle that, because it happened, then you come to a certain angry level, then when you talk, if you let it go, then I'm not doing my job for the company.
When you practice loving kindness before you go to work, and you run across someone that is not meeting their expectations, and you radiate loving kindness to them, you can discuss it without anger. And it becomes very logical. And they'll see where they're messing up. If they don't, you can say, well, maybe you'd do better doing something else. But it doesn't have to come from anger and dissatisfaction and hatred and that sort of thing.
If it has happened in the past, then I have to let that person go, they might suffer a lot at the end, saying, oh my God, how is he going to put the food on the table? You know, when you let that person
discussing the problem, and whether he chooses to acknowledge that it's a problem and was willing to change or not is his problem. You give that person, this is what's required. If you don't think that you're going to be able to do that, then it's better for you to move along and find something else that you're more suited for. But it comes from a space of not I'm right and you're wrong. It's just that this is a job that needs to be done. And if you're not going to do it the way that it needs to be done, then I have to find somebody else that's going to do it that way, because this is what's required. Okay?
Ante, what I'm hearing is that he's suffering because of discharging him. So that's the reaction that he's having.
His
so
mental, that's his mental proliferation about the situation. Well, it'd be nice that people would cooperate all the time, but it just doesn't happen that way. I mean, the real world is such that some people are not going to be suitable for one job, but they're completely suitable for another. So you're giving them the opportunity to go find what they're more suitable to do, what's more suitable for them to do. It's the road to it. It's the path that leads to it.
Well, jhana is a path that leads to that.
Right.
So if a person reaches so on, then that person stays there as long as he practices or can come down and go there. And it's how do you know that, that any person is in that level? But like what means?
I know how to ask the questions to see where they are. Let's put it that way. Jhana, most people, when you ask them what is a jhana, they will tell you it's absorption concentration. That's not the definition that the Buddha, from the Buddha's teaching. That's the definition from the Brahman, the Vedic teachings. The definition that I use for jhana with the Buddha's teaching is each jhana is a level of understanding. Understanding what, how everything works. How dependent origination works. And you teach it to yourself. Anybody else? Yeah.
So that's where the idea comes from, that if you have a jhana, then you can't lose it. That you have an understanding, you can't forget that you know this.
Right.
So there you've got a step.
Right. And it is a level that is such good merit, so pure a mind, that if you experience a jhana one time, when you die from this realm, you'll be reborn in a Brahmaloka. You're going to be reborn in a very happy existence.
American dog.
I don't know what that means.
People say that I want to be reborn as an American dog.
not even close to that. And when you're reborn in a Brahma Loka, the food that you need to continue on being in that realm is joy. Joy. Yeah. Right.
And it's that tangible experience that really is what solidifies the understanding.
Right.
In the process.
Right. And even if you just experience the first jhana, your level of understanding is not very good, but the joy that you experience is something that will come up right before you die, so you'll be reborn in a Brahma Loka.
Where does I heard everything that you said, and where does appreciation fall in? Is that a bad thing? Like, I see the flowers and they're beautiful and I smile. Do I just don't put any meaning to it? Is that the source? Because if there's good, then there's the not good. Is it okay to be seen?
Of course. One of the things that happen once you begin on this path is your mind becomes much more clear. And instead, let's do it with food. Okay, I'll give you an example of something that happened to me. I learned about this and how taste arose. And I wanted to see the feeling arise, and I wanted to see how the taste arose, and that nice feeling that goes with it, and how that process worked. So I took a piece of mango, which I truly love, and I put it on my tongue, and I saw the contact, and I saw the feeling arise, and then I saw the craving. I like that. That's good stuff. And all of a sudden, I was starting to think about, you know, that's a good mango, but I had one better yesterday. And then all of a sudden, you're thinking about something else, and you're thinking about something else while you're still eating the mango. Okay? So when you catch that craving, I like it, and then you don't have those, then you don't have that, those thoughts about thinking about something else while you're eating.
Which flowers are beautiful, but as soon as my mind starts to say, oh, but they were more beautiful yesterday, then I would six-R that thought.
You bet.
And just go back to just what they are.
Right.
So that's okay.
Yes.
Good. I was worried because I just see that
and actually,
so much alike that I thought, oh my God, are you telling me that I have to...
No. You start appreciating it that much more because you don't have distractions pulling you away thinking about this or that. So, you actually develop deep appreciation without distraction. Okay? Anybody else? Yeah.
So in this appreciation, why is dancing and music forbidden? Is that how it makes the looping pattern in mind?
It causes excitement. See that, and it's only while you are in retreat. Monks don't dance and sing, or they're not supposed to. But when you take the eight precepts here, you don't use things that scents and odors and that sort of thing, and you don't sing and dance because you're doing the mental development. When you get off retreat, you don't have that precept anymore. Okay. And you can go sing and dance all you want.
So do you think that the thing that catches us in the singing and dancing is the repeating quality of it, that it's
well,
setting up these loops?
And it takes you out of the present moment.
Yeah.
You ever have a song repeat itself over and over in your mind?
I just want to share an experience which I think reflects. There was a long time ago I read a quote by actually Abraham Lincoln, which was talking about the destruction of enemies. And I understood it intellectually, but recently I understood it more personally, which was they asked after the Civil War, well, you need to punish your enemies. We need to punish them. We need to destroy them. And he goes, I'm going to destroy my enemies by making them my friends.
Yeah.
It made sense, but no.
Yeah, that's why they shot him. I'm sorry, I couldn't. I just couldn't help myself.
That's a YouTube clip.
Yeah, I'm sure it's going to make it. Okay. Let's share some merit then. May suffering ones be suffering free, and the fear-struck fearless be. May the grieving shed all grief, and may all beings find relief. May all beings share this merit that we've thus acquired for the acquisition of all kinds of happiness. May beings inhabiting space and earth, devas and nagas of mighty powers, share this merit of ours. May they long protect the Buddha's dispensations.